discussion afterwards. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Well, I will talk about the project called Making Europe. It's a project I've been working on the last 10 years. It's a project that involves 300 scholars from across Europe. It produces loads of output. One of them is a series of articles and books published. There are a lot of graduate students attached to it, so these are PhD theses published as books. But there's also a kind of central output, which consists of 6 volumes and a digital museum. So what I will do is I will talk about the kind of central conception behind the entire program, research program, because the ambition in this research program is to write a new history of Europe. And one of the questions is, of course, why do we need a new history of Europe in the first place? Secondly, I will talk about my own book, because there are 6 books produced. 2 are already out. They are here. They are nicely produced with many pictures, and that's one of the features of this project, that we really use visual material as source material. So if you read this book and you read only the pictures, you get the sense of the book, because there are captions. So there is a separate argument made through the pictures. Okay, here you see the 6 volumes, the first 2 are out, and you see the digital museum. The subtitle is Technology and Transformations, 1815 till 2000. So what is new about this, in any case, that we try to write the history of Europe through the lens of technology. And that's not often done, because there's a lot of history writing without mentioning or even referring to technology. I know a lot of 20th century history, for example, that doesn't talk about the car. Well, if you think about what changed in our lives, and you think about the car and the impact the car had, how can you write that kind of history? So this project has to be seen as a kind of attempt to bring back technology into the historical picture and what it meant. But secondly, what we do is we try to circumvent the fact that in the 20th century, a lot of the histories are about the wars. So the wars are really put central, and the nation states fighting with each other. So is there another history beyond this that can be told? Well, here you have the 6 books. These first 2 are out. So the first one is about consumption. The second one is about the European Knowledge Society. We have one about infrastructure. Well, that's the one by me, written together with Wolfram Keiser. There's one on communication, and there's one on Europe in the global world, because we also believe that you cannot write the European history as an isolated history. You need to put it into a global context. Well, this is the... So there's a... Does the link is active? Yes. So this is what we also did. We built a digital museum. So what is the digital museum? You can see here 6 exhibitions. So each book is translated in an exhibition on the web. And we work with 10 museums, including the Science Museum in London. And we use their collection to tell the history. So if you would click on one of them, then you see tours. And a tour consists of 6 units. And if you would go to this, so here you see what is called an object. That comes from one of the museums. So what we've done, we added a story. So we contextualize this object, but we also connect several objects. So we transnationalize the collections of museums. So there's an object in the Science Museum, and it's often told with a British story attached to it. But we say, no, there's also a European story or another story attached to it. And we make the connection between the object in the Science Museum and an object in the Deutsches Museum and an object in another museum. So we make all these connections. And then you can explore with the partners' collections. So you can do a lot of explorations into their collections and find more and related content. So it's an expanding universe. As you can see, there's an education page. So this has been used now across Europe by 3,000 students that have been experimenting with this. So we have developed a whole set of assignments that you can use in the classroom, from intensive to... And then we have built a learning environment called My Europe, where you have to, everyone can sign in. You can create your own account and you can sign in. And then you can create your own tour. So students can now, and that's what I've done myself, they can create their own Europe, their own vision of Europe through objects. So they learn how to contextualize objects, how to connect them. So you can have students working, and it's very nice because each student needs to work on his own object, but needs to connect to other students working on other objects, and they need to create a larger story out of that. And they can also work across borders with each other. So this is the digital museum bit. So the project, the kind of main result is the 6 books and the digital museum. And they are connected, and they are connected also to an educational offering. Okay, let's come back to the question, why do we need a new history of Europe? Well, if you look at what's available, you can see there are 2 types of histories available of Europe currently. One type of history, I'm sure you're familiar with, is a type of history where the nation state is central, and then it's all about the difficult relationships between these nation states. So European history is a history of France, the UK, Germany, put in one book. You can compare them, but basically they're national histories and a set of relationships, often conflictual relationships. So this is pictured here as a comic map that was made in the end of the 19th century. But that's one type of European history. In this European history, the European integration history is a footnote. Because this type of history will say, European integration is a part of international relations. So it will only get 1 or 2 pages, typically. So it's seen as not very important, European integration process, because the locus of power and the main actor in history is the nation state. The second history, which is very different, is the history of European integration. So that's another type of European history. And the idea there is that something real new started after the Second World War. Because of course the 20th century is the age of extremes. So you had a very bloody first part and a very prosperous second part. And what's the explanation for this shift? It's the EU. The EU guaranteed peace and guaranteed economic development. Of course there, you know, you can see the communist threat. The fact that the EU was a Cold War project should not be forgotten. It was meant, because of course after the Second World War, it was very difficult to think about rebuilding Germany. But the Americans didn't want to stay in Germany, it would be too costly. They needed a strong Germany against the Russians, in their view. But how can you argue in 1948 to the French that you need a strong military base in Germany? Difficult. So the EU was a project to circumvent that problem. Because it would integrate, you would build a strong Germany as part of Europe. Okay, I show you a very brief movie, because this perception of what European integration was, because that's one of the main things that I also will be talking about, to challenge this European integration history and myth about its own origin. I will show you a movie where this is explained. There's no voice, there's no sound. Without sound, it doesn't work. There's no sound? Okay, if there's no...
What was the sound?
Is this disconnection?
We need speakers.
Are there no speakers here? No speakers. What we do without them. Okay.
You're not playing it now, are you?
No. Okay, then we leave it. No. Okay. Well, we leave it.
I can't see.
Okay. The movie was presenting a self-image of the EU, how it portrays itself, and it was making the point that the European integration process is a real fundamental revolution comparable to the French Revolution, and it's a complete new departure in European history. So that's one of the views I want to look at. If you look through the lens of technology to this process, would you come to a similar conclusion? So now I would like to talk about this lens of technology, and then we start with objects. So this is one of the objects that you can find in the digital museum. And the question is, how can we contextualize this object? So what is it? Can anyone tell me? It has been a very important object, I can tell you. A real integrating Europe object.
Yes.
So what is it?
Changing
bolts,
like big square objects or screws, like a screwdriver.
Spanner? No. It's a key. It's the key, it's called the Bern key. Engineers negotiated 10 years about this key between 1880 and 1819. Because in Europe, in the 19th century, we see the emergence of new train systems. And we have to think this was a private business, mainly. There were some government-funded and government railways. There were many, many companies, hundreds of companies, and they were crossing borders. They all had their own systems. And at first, it was not a big problem in the middle of the 19th century. But nation-states started to become were building up, and they wanted to control the flows. So they started to create barriers. So many of these railway companies had lines across borders. They got into trouble because nation states started to create frontiers. So they became more national. But in any case, many of them had their own keys for their wagons. And if you would cross the border, hello, welcome. If you would cross the border, and you would start to mix wagons from different companies, it became a mess. So they wanted to have a kind of standard. But the standardization not only applied to keys, but also applied to platforms, wagon development, access, the gauge, of course. Many of these aspects all needed to be standardized. So engineers started to negotiate around this, and at first, the question was, who should negotiate international standards? Well, in the 19th century, the first answer was because the nation state, well, this is the task of a diplomat. This is the task of the Foreign Office. The Foreign Office had problems. How can they deal? You know, they had no knowledge. So they brought in some experts to go with them to meetings. But the experts then, you know, they already were meeting in kind of engineering societies. So they knew each other. They were working together. They said to each other, we don't need the diplomats. Let's keep them out, because they do political games. We don't want them. So experts started to come together and develop standards, like this one, artifacts, to make it possible for all kinds of systems, energy systems, communication systems, transport systems, to cross borders. This is typically a meeting. This is a meeting of the Transit, Communication and Transit Committee of the League of Nations in the interwar period. So they were sitting here and negotiating standards. So this was one of the places. We tend to think that the League of Nations was a big failure. In history, it's seen as a big, big failure and as something to avoid. Well, in the technical sphere, which was a large part of the work of the League of Nations, also in healthcare, also on migration issue, many areas, they were very successful, in fact, quite successful. So we need to rewrite, through the lens of technology, the history of the League of Nations. In any case, so this is an example. Of course, it's highly gendered. It was a male business. Well, here you see them sitting on, these are experts of the UN Economic Commission for Europe. So after the war, the UN got regional commissions, and they were also doing a lot of technical work. So in fact, they were taking up all the work done by the League of Nations. And you see here that they are looking at a map. They are constructing a European transport network, and this led to the E-road network. So the European E-road network is not developed by the EU, it's developed by the UN Economic Commission for Europe. And it's important, so here you have all the national flags, and you see that the participating nations differ from the ones that participated originally in the EU. And in fact, if you look at all the systems and all the standards developing, you always see a different set of nation states participating. So you get a kind of very fragmented system of standards applying to different geographical spaces. Well, this is another project, space. Of course, there were these big, large projects. CERN is another project, all happening outside the EU. Well, one of the important things is also that a lot of European projects were developed in the colonies. So in this series, we look not at the diffusion so much, the diffusion of European technology to the rest of the world. We look how it is coming back. Because the rest of the world was used as a laboratory, often, for designing new systems. Concentration camps is a famous example, experimented with by the British in South Africa, that came back, and Hitler explicitly used all the experience, but there are many other examples. But also urban planning, because you had a tabula rasa situation, according to urban planners, in the colonies. So new techniques for urban planning were tried out in the colonies and came back to Europe. And they were called European technology. That's also interesting. The Dutch, when they were in the Dutch Indies, they introduced themselves not as Dutch, but as Europeans. So in that context, like when they visited America, it's the same. They became European. Well, we also look at consumption, because in this book series and this program, we see consumers as innovators. So the users are not only end user applying, but they are part of the process. So what you see here is a, does anyone know what this is? It's a paper pattern. So if you want to make your own clothes, you can radieren. I don't know the English word. You make the paper pattern out of it. It's a very complex. So there was a lot of fashion developed in Paris, in other cities, and this was spread throughout Europe through women that did a lot of the work. They all produced their own clothes with these paper patterns, but then they were tinkering with it as well. So there was a whole industry of making fashionable clothing, which became a European industry, and it became a kind of way of Europeanizing fashion throughout Europe through the active collaboration of all these women producing their own clothes and tinkering and developing it further. So that's also the kind of processes we look at. So we see these women as part of the standardization process. So they're not part of the committees, but they did a lot of work on the ground in many areas. So this is another area where we look at consumers and tourism. So what you see is that a lot of agents, because all these infrastructures became available, transport infrastructures, they started to develop the notion of European touring. So they developed a new practice through these guides, and there were often a series of hotels connected to it, so they developed packages of European touring. And the interesting thing, of course, is that here, if you see, because we look at what is included and what is excluded, you see this is included, this is part of Europe, apparently. And if you look in this book series, we look a lot to, into the Cold War period and to all the connections that exist across the Iron Curtain. Because it appears to be there were many, many connections, a lot more than we thought. Technological connections, but also tourists producing their own version of Europe. Okay. Here you can see some of the conclusions. So there are many processes across borders that implicated knowledge, products, processes, skills, systems of provision, infrastructures. And the concept we use to follow them is we use the concept circulation, and then we look at the local appropriation, how they are used and appropriated, and how that led then to the formation of new, for example, consumer patterns or new standards or new consumption experiences or new regimes. And we look at linking and delinking, so we look at inclusion and exclusion. And it's also interesting that in this period, Europe emerges as a identity that wants to perceive itself as a knowledge society. And it's also a crucial, what's called, measure to differentiate themselves from the colonies. The colonies are seen as societies where there is no knowledge available that needs to be diffused to them. And Europe is the place where there's high tech and knowledge developed. So this kind of identification between knowledge and Europe started in the 19th century. And of course the Lisbon Agenda is a kind of part of this long-term process of this connection made. But as we want to show, of course, is that knowledge, if you look at, again, at these paper patterns, so the question is, of course, what is knowledge? Is this included? Well, what does our story, this Europe from the bottom up, do? It, in a way, decenters, on the one hand, the EU. Because it says the EU was a latecomer. There were many, many organizations building Europe. And there were many Europe-building practices long before 45. And the European Union is a latecomer and had a lot of difficulty in the beginning. I will give you a case of trying to get its own place. So it was not a start. It was a finishing touch, perhaps. When you take a more long-term perspective. What's also, so we introduced the concept of long 20th century in this respect, and we oppose it to the short-term 20th century because Erik Hobsbawm introduced the concept of the short 20th century because he sees the end of the First World War and the fall of the Berlin Wall as the kind of major political events which determined European history. We have a much longer view and focus a lot more on continuities because many of these technical processes we look at, that's also important, were shared, for example, in wars across the countries. So many of the experts, I've looked at, you know, they were collaborating before the war, during the war, and after the war. So there's a lot of continuity, in fact. And there's a lot of shared history instead of this history of opposing forces, you know, the evil forces and the good forces fighting, and in the end, you know, we have the kind of winner, the liberal democratic society. Well, we tell a bit a different story. We also say that European integration was fragmented from the start, and perhaps the core of the process is fragmentation. Why? Because you have all these processes building Europe, and they are all layered. So you have many, many standards and they do not really fit with each other, but it works somehow. So fragmentation is perhaps, and the slogan of the EU is unity in diversity. And of course the mystical question is, how can unity emerge out of diversity? So in one conversation to the Commission, I proposed to say, divided we stand, as a kind of alternative to the unity in diversity. They didn't accept it, so. One important point, okay, what is typical European? Well, one thing that's typical in European is interfacing. So the process of interfacing. If you go back to the key I showed you, because the key consisted of two parts. It was not one key, in fact, two keys. Why? Because the end result of the negotiation was, we need a key to represent the French coordinated zone and the German coordinated zone. So it was a key that consisted of two parts that could be put together that represented Europe. And this is a typical European solution. And we use the notion of the hidden integration of Europe to refer to all these layers. Okay, so this is the kind of general program. And in the book I've been involved in, we focus on standard setting and on the role of experts. This picture will be the cover picture, like here, cover picture. This is the of the book that will be published in October. And what you see here is a train that was celebrating the coal and steel community establishment, and it was going through all the six countries that were part of the coal and steel community. And of course you see the national symbols of the countries. So you can see two sectors here represented that we focus on in the book. That's the steel sector and the transport sector. Why these two? Because both were crucial to the origins of the European integration process as it started after the Second World War. So both were very central, but both had kind of opposing outcomes. And I want to look at transport first, because transport was one of the central planks in the treaty. So if you look to the Treaty of Rome, you see that because they have this idea of a common market that needs to be established, but the common market needs an infrastructure. And they realize that, so transport needs to provide the infrastructure for the common market. And this is a quote from the famous Schuman Declaration, and you see that how they quote the material aspect. So they think that if you tie nations together materially, that you make war impossible. So if you integrate steel factories and steel production, if you integrate transport systems, then countries will not go to war anymore. So they have this explicit notion and of doing this. And the question is, where does it come from? But the notion is, you integrate through technology. And why do you integrate through technology? Well, first of all, they think you can have fast results. Here's one of the quotes from the first European Council of Europe meetings. It's easy and obtain tangible results very quickly. But the idea is also, you do not have to involve the public. You can do it by stealth. So the idea is, if we integrate technically and economically, there will be spillovers. So there will be pressures built up for political integration. So let's take a detour through the technical, and through this detour create political integration. So this was an explicit, very explicit aim of the integration process from the start. Well, this thinking that you can integrate through technology started in the 19th century. So in the 19th century, this was precisely what the experts were creating. This kind of idea that you can integrate and prevent war
through infrastructures. Of course, the First World War proved in a way that this was impossible. But the answer of the experts was, well, we had not integrated enough. We need to do more. So the League of Nations was part of this project of integrating more and better. And after the Second World War, the EU is yet another attempt to integrate. And through the same process, an integration through experts, that would then lead to political integration. Think about what is one of the central actors in the EU. That's the Commission. What is the Commission? The Commission is a set of experts. They have to be experts. They cannot represent a nation. As soon as they are in Brussels, a commissioner, he or she should not represent his or her nation or any other interest. He should be completely independent, an expert, and the experts sit together in the Commission and develop proposals. And already they were the only ones who had the right to develop proposals. This is an exact copy of the decision-making structure developed in the 19th century in all these technical organizations. So the EU is, in a very deep sense, very, very technocratic. And the Commission is, of course, part of any treaty signed. So whatever reform you do, you have to rewrite all the treaties. Well, the transport, so they wanted to integrate transport through this route, and it failed completely. So this is the first commissioner, Walter Hallstein, and he said, you know, nothing happened. This is, so it was a complete failure, transport integration. Can you ask the question, how can we explain this failure? Well, it's often explained as because of resistance of the nation state. Because if you look at the European integration literature, you can see that the dynamic of explanations is there's a fight between the Commission or Brussels and the nation state, and the question is who wins. And then there's a process of deepening and widening. So deepening is getting more powers to Brussels, and widening is enlargement. So, and then there's, you know, because some people will say, okay, Brussels only exists because it's a kind of international organization. It's only a permanent organization. It's a permanent platform for negotiation, but the nation states are still central and they decide. So everything that Europe is doing is servicing the nation state. A common market is very, very good because it really helps to build up competitive positions for all the nation states. There's no real power in Brussels. Or never there was real power transferred. That's one position in the debate. The other position is no, there is a, it's more, it's something else, it's a proto-superstate, the EU. It's working towards becoming a new state through this process of spillover. So we integrate technically, we have spillovers.
Johan,
yeah.
How come is it a failure? I don't get why is it a failure.
Well,
okay. Travel from Lisbon to Hamburg by train.
Okay, that's why is it a failure? Well, the EU wanted to acquire a part of the treaty. It said the EU or its predecessor, the European Economic Community, said we want to become the main actor in transport integration. Well, as I showed you in these two quotes, they failed completely. They were not able to develop any standard. They were not able to develop any power in that area. So the question is, if the transport the common transport policy of the EU is such a failure, how come that we can do all this traveling? Well, the answer is not. The answer is because there were these other organizations doing it. So the part of the story we are telling here is that there were many, many other organizations integrating Europe. The EU had many competitors. And if you want to understand why the EU was successful or not, you should not only look at the resistance of nation states, but you should look at the transnational level, at the competition by all these other actors. And these actors were driven by the same technocratic understanding of how to make decisions. So in that sense, they were quite similar to the EU. They had a very technocratic decision-making structure. Only they did not believe in the spillover. They didn't want, because they saw the EU as a project driven by politicians, by people with political objects misusing the technical for their aims. So they said, we don't need the EU, so they explicitly tried to keep it out. We do it ourselves. So these experts were coordinating, working against the EU, and ensuring that it would never become a success. And they were very, very successful up to the 80s in doing this. And they had all these projects. So these are projects they developed to integrate Europe. The E-road system, this is the TER system, a scheme, you know, that you can, as a freight, can easily cross borders. There's a bus system, there's a railway system, there's a wagon pool. The Eurofirma is a way to finance international endeavors, so it's a financing mechanism. So this is the declaration for the EU network. So you can see, so this is the EU network. Just to show you, this is the Trans-European Express. So the argument is, Europe was built not by the EU, partly, but by many other organizations. So there are many, many Europe-building organizations, competitors to the EU, and driven by these experts. So here's a map of the Trans-European, and part of the argument is also there were different Europe. So this is a specific Europe. You know, there are certain things excluded and other things included. So again, this kind of layering aspect is important. The argument in the book is that in the 19th century and in the 20th century, we see a specific way of making international decisions emerging, what we call technocratic internationalism. So this is, how do we do international relations? The idea was not through diplomats. Let's avoid diplomacy. It was driven by these three aspects. One is the kind of myth of the network, the idea if you integrate people materially, you integrate them mentally too. So infrastructures, building transnational infrastructures, technological network prevents war, basically, and creates all kinds of positive benefits. The other idea was, and that's typical, we know technocracy as a kind of way of thinking to avoid class conflict. People promoting technocracy will say there's no real class conflict. It's only made up by the managers and so on. If we are in power, the experts, we can avoid class conflict. It's a similar way they argued, if we are in power of international relations, we will never have conflicts between nation states. Because we are rational people, we will just look at all the stakes, we will come together, deliberate, and come up with conclusions. So they had their own political strategy, and they assumed a harmony between national and international interest. Yes, there is nationalism, but nationalism is only a problem in the hands of the wrong people, politicians and policymakers. Let's avoid them. So they worked through what we call technification. So they made, we looked at all these working committee experts' reports that many historians never look at because they're deep down in the archive and in the organization. And there you can see how through a strategy of technification they came to an agreement, and it was voluntary because these experts never wanted to have a treaty. They say a treaty, then again you bring in the diplomats. Let's voluntarily agree. So the Dutch, German, French experts come together, they have their deliberations, they agree. And then they will implement it nationally themselves. Because they have a lot of power nationally. So they go home and integrate it. Voluntarily. That's the kind of what we call technological internationalism. Well, here, Günter Myrdal, which is a kind of hero in history often seen, the head of the UNECE, you see one of his quotes. And this explains
technocratic internationalism. And this was a reflection about these years with the European Commission for Europe and how they worked. So not made public, unhampered and effective discussion, stress was from the beginning laid on the technical and non-political character. Issues were never put to vote, so the whole issue about majority voting, experts would bring in three experts from France and only one from Germany, was never a problem. Because, you know, they were discussing and voting was never an issue. According to Middel. Here's another quote. You know, you can see underlying the technical and non-political nature of the questions and avoiding all publicity, the highest level of secrecy was held. No written protocols, no votes, secret clubs. Its history is yet to be written. Well, that's the history I've written. But it's important to understand, so this was, of course, a political strategy. They call it non-political, but it was a political strategy how to integrate Europe through the technical, which is the basis also of the EU. So it really poses some questions about the future of the EU, and we can talk about that. So the answer here to the question was the common transport policy might have been a failure. It was. But transport integration, to some extent, we can discuss the modalities, but was not. But other people did it, experts who had a specific integration philosophy. So they filled, so the experts, what's in the international relations literature called a regulatory gap, because many of the regulations are nationally organized. I encountered this when I moved here, the difference in pension regulations between countries. So how do you mediate between them? Well, this is what the experts did. Of course, what it led to was a lot of fragmentation. They never saw this as a problem, because they had all these systems, they were constantly interfacing, so you have a lot of diversity, in fact, which is not a problem, but really cooperating quite well. Well, this is the table of contents of the book. So the first part, we write the history of this technocratic internationalism, in a more general sense. Then we have our two case studies, railway and steel, and then we talk about reasons why the EU, after 85, was able to dismantle a lot of these structures that I showed that were effective up till 85, was able to dismantle them. Thank you.